The story of Utah is a unique and a fascinating tale. While our geography and pioneer history and the road to statehood were unique from other states, we take great pride in this unique heritage. The area we now call Utah has been populated for many generations. The harsh geography was home to many Native American inhabitants, and it was certainly an obstacle to the Spanish explorers and the fur traders and the wagon trains and others who passed through this area as quickly as they could. But those that stayed prospered. What the early settlers could not know in 1847 was the enormous potential of this state. Through discipline, planning, hard work, and cultural as well as religious diversity, Utah today stands as a jewel in the crown of America. I invite you to enjoy this fascinating story that will help you to understand why we're so proud of this lasting heritage.
The long trek across America's frontier was nearing a close. The travel had been rough after leaving the Oregon Trail on the plains of Wyoming. Everyone was tired and anxious, and their leader, Brigham Young, had been ill for the past few days.
It is enough. This is the right place. Drive on.
Hi, I'm Merlin Olsen. A lot has changed since that July day in 1847. At a spot near here, Brigham Young and the Mormon pioneers saw the Salt Lake Valley and the Great Basin as it had existed for thousands of years, a semi-arid land inhabited only by Indians that eked out their existence amid the sagebrush and wooded canyons. With the hot midsummer sun drying the grasses of the valley, it must have been a shock to those first pioneers. It was such a stark contrast to the lush Iowa and Illinois farmlands that they had left behind. Some must have felt disappointed by the look of their new home. One of the women said, "I don't remember a tree that could be called a tree." Another remarked that she would rather go on 1,000 miles more than stop in such a dreary place. But despite such misgivings, most of the journals of the day recounted a joy and thanksgiving for reaching a sanctuary where they could build their homes in peace. As we look out on the Salt Lake Valley from This Is the Place Monument, what we see today is a far cry from what met the eyes of those pioneers. But beneath those modern buildings, the lawns and parks of our towns and cities, lies the same basic geography that has been Utah for millennia. The geography of Utah has played a major role in the history of the state. From its deserts to forests dotted with lakes and streams, majestic mountain peaks, and salt flats so smooth that they are used for land speed records. This unique geographic diversity brought the Indians, the Spanish, the trappers, the Mormons, the miners, and today it brings the tourist.
When many people think of Utah, they think of the salt flats, but the salt flats are not typical to the state of Utah. There are other divisions as well, and each has played a very significant role in the development and settlement of the state.
There are three separate and distinct geographic provinces or landform divisions that come together in Utah. Each of these provinces has been crucial in both the ancient and modern history of Utah. As Brigham Young and his entourage were looking out over the Salt Lake Valley in 1847, they were actually seeing spread out before them what geologists now refer to as the Great Basin. It starts at just about where the group was standing and extends to the Sierra Nevada Range in California. The nearest mountains they viewed, looking across the Salt Lake Valley, were the Ochre Mountains. This Great Basin is just that, an inland basin with no natural water access to the ocean. In the lower parts of this basin, stream water accumulates, then eventually dries up because of the hot, dry summers, leaving behind mineral salts, such as those that we see at the edge of the Great Salt Lake.
The inland sea we see around us here is a salton sea. It is known as the Great Salt Lake. It's a very salty lake, being about 5 to 9 times saltier than the ocean. No fish live in this lake. Great Salt Lake is a remnant of a much larger lake which existed about 10,000 years ago. This lake was known as Lake Bonneville and occupied an area about 20,000 square miles. This ancient lake had formed many beaches at its upper shores. And as you look around the landscape of the valley, you'll see many of these ancient shorelines as flat terraces on these lower hill slopes.
The Great Basin is only one physiographic province of the state. In the southeastern and south-central part of the state, the landscape is quite different. We refer to the province here as the Colorado Plateau because it is an uplifted segment of horizontal layers of sandstone, into which the Colorado River and its tributaries have cut deep canyons and gorges. Although much of the area is still very dry, like the Great Basin, there are more colorful exposed rocks in hues of red, brown, and orange that dominate the area. This spectacular scenery has provided a base for 4 national parks, several state parks, as well as national monuments and recreational areas. Lake Powell, a man-made lake in the gorges of the Colorado River, is one of the most popular recreational areas in the western United States. The last geographic province in the state of Utah is a section of the Rocky Mountains which forms what we call today the Uinta and Wasatch Ranges. These jagged peaks of the Wasatch Range were formed by violent upsurges of the Earth's crust, Faulting and earthquake activity is responsible for the abrupt western face that we call the Wasatch Front. The complex geology of this range provided the rich veins of silver, gold, and other metals that gave rise to the mining towns of Alta and Park City. Likewise, the exposure of granite near the mouth of Little Cottonwood Canyon provided important building materials for the Salt Lake Temple. In spite of the fact that the Wasatch had more faulting and significant uplift, the peaks of the Uinta Mountains are the highest in the state, with King's Peak extending more than 13,000 feet above sea level. As you will see, the different geologic formations in Utah have played vital roles in Utah's unique human history as well. However deserted and uninhabited the Great Basin may have looked to those early Mormon pioneers, it had actually been inhabited continuously for more than 10,000 years. The pioneers were really Johnny-come-latelys, the last in a string of residents and visitors into the area we now refer to as Utah. The Native Americans were the first, and they left enough evidence to tell us a great deal about them.
We're here at Danger Cave, an important archaeological site on the edge of the Salt Flats near Wendover. This cave contained an archaeological record that documented its use for a period of over 10,000 years by people. Prehistorically, there was a lush marsh that covered the area out in front of the cave. Now it's all dry. It was dried up in the 20th century by improvements that took the water elsewhere. But this marsh was used, and it was a magnet for prehistoric people. We know that there were large populations in a whole lot of different places. There were, by some estimates, more people living in southeastern Utah 1,000 years ago than there are now. The Fremont culture and the Anasazi culture are both farming cultures. The Fremont and the Anasazi also hunted and gathered quite a bit for their food, but they lived in more or less permanent villages and stored their corn and crops and lived a pretty sedentary lifestyle, although they did a lot of moving around. They lived in Utah from about the time of Christ until farming conditions deteriorated around 1200 to 1300 AD, at which time we see more or less the disappearance of the Fremont culture and the abandonment of the Anasazi area by the Anasazi. Following that abandonment, we see archaeological evidence of the people who we found historically living in Utah, the Utes, the Shoshone, the Paiutes, the Goshutes, and the Navajo, the historic tribes of the area.
According to the Navajos, according to my mother, the Anasazis were ones that began to experiment. They kind of lost their spirituality, but they began to delve in other things, eventually forgetting about the more important things. Our various artifacts, like the Navajo wedding basket, the jewelry that we wear, all those things really tie in to the beginning of the Navajo way of life. As time goes on today, we share some of these thoughts in the schools and in the community that we need to preserve the language and the culture more and more. We can learn a lot of things from the Anasazis. And so today we teach the young people about don't be doing the things that the Anasazis went through, and that is to lose your culture and your spiritual way of living, because you will end up the same way that they did. You will be gone also.
One of the first well-documented explorations of this area by Europeans was the great expedition of two Spanish priests, Fathers Dominguez and Escalante, in 1776. While the American Revolutionary War raged on, the Spanish fathers were seeking a shorter trading route between the Spanish colonies of Santa Fe and California. The large procession must have been quite a sight as it wound its way through the wilderness. Their diary was well recorded and well published for later generations. And the expedition maps drawn by Miera E. Pachinko were of such high quality that even today one can retrace the steps of this expedition with a high degree of accuracy. Pachinko mapped the rivers like the Green in the Colorado, as well as Utah Lake, and was aware of the Great Salt Lake. Although the expedition didn't reach the Great Salt Lake, they were told fascinating stories about a great salty sea whose waters were noxious and guarded by a tribe of witch doctors and wizards. Naturally, Pachinko assumed the huge lake must have a great river flowing westward to the Pacific Ocean. So he drew a non-existent river on his map, flowing from the Great Salt Lake to the west. Many subsequent explorers and traders spent considerable time searching for this great river, but to no avail. The theory wasn't disproved until 70 years later, when explorers such as John C. Fremont made extensive surveys of the area. They discovered the truth. The Great Basin had no outlet to the sea. While visiting what is today Utah Valley, much Christian evangelizing was done by the Franciscan fathers to the native populations along the way. These tribes, for the most part, were very cordial and accommodating. There were previous explorations into Utah by the Spanish, but they were not very well documented. Some northern expeditions by the Spanish were in direct violation of bans by the Spanish government. These rogue expeditions gave rise to fascinating stories of lost Spanish mines in the Uinta Mountains of Utah, and were greatly circulated in the 17th and 18th centuries. These same stories persist to this day.
The Uinta Mountains, a place with a lot of mystery and a lot of legend, legends that are born here, and that they're kept alive by the spirit of the prospector, the adventurer, the explorer. The stories of the old Spaniards coming in looking for gold. Before Escalante came, people today still search out these seven cities of gold, and they still search out the El Dorado and the Josephine. Who knows, maybe even this mine that we're sitting in might be the famous lost Josephine mine.
The years following the Dominguez Escalante expedition were somewhat chaotic for the newly formed and rapidly growing United States. The Louisiana Purchase from France added even more new territory, but did not clearly define the northern and western borders. The European craving for beaver pelts added to the confusion as the Russians, English, Spanish, French, and Americans all fought for control of the rich fur-trapping beds of the Pacific Northwest. It was this quest for beaver that brought more Europeans into Utah. As the great fur-trapping fields of the Northwest started to play out, the sights of the trappers turned to the Rocky Mountain area. By treaty, the American trappers were to stay above the 42nd parallel, which is just above the present-day border between Utah and Idaho. But land navigation was a little bit primitive, and some confrontations were bound to happen. A company of American trappers made their way from St. Louis to the Rockies and into present-day Cache Valley. They included the likes of Jedediah Smith, James Bridger, and John Weber. During the same year, an expedition of British trappers from the Hudson Bay Company came to the area, led by Peter Skeen Ogden. Eventually, both groups converged in the area around present-day Mountain Green, and arguments ensued about the trapping rights. Ogden found his men outnumbered and in open revolt. After over 20 men defected to the American Trapping Company, Ogden voluntarily left the area, which ironically now bears his name. The American fur trappers that remained established trading posts such as Fort Bridger in Wyoming and Fort Buenaventura near present-day Ogden. Popular belief insists that it was Jim Bridger who first saw the Great Salt Lake, and he did so to settle a bet. While spending time in a wintering camp near the Bear River, arguments arose as to the outlet of the river. Bets were taken, and Jim Bridger and some others set out to settle the wager. After arriving on the shores of the Great Salt Lake, they took a drink, only to discover a briny salt solution.
Hell, we're at the shores of the Pacific.
Jedediah Smith, however, was the trapper who explored more of the area of western Utah than any other. He extensively explored the Great Salt Lake and confirmed the fact that it was a dead sea with no outlet and was not the Pacific Ocean. He blazed trails to both northern and southern California, trails that the Mormons used decades later when they colonized the West. A trapper from a different company out of Taos, New Mexico, explored and trapped in an area quite a ways south of the Bear Lake area, where Weber and Smith were operating. ATN Provost spent time near present-day Utah Lake and the Great Salt Lake. His name was later anglicized into Provo and became the name of one of the state's major cities. Whether it was the search for beaver or the natural curiosity of the mountain men, their trails and explorations of the Great Basin and other parts of Utah were very important to future pioneers.
Brigham Young is a prominent figure in Utah and Mormon history, and for good reason. Brigham Young was the leader of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints during a very important transitional time period for the church and for the settlement and growth of the West. At the age of 30, Brigham Young was told about this man, Joseph Smith, who had received a very significant revelation while praying in a grove of trees near his home. Brigham was also told about a book known as the Book of Mormon, which was inscribed on gold plates by ancient prophets. These plates contained a record of the inhabitants of the Americas and is revered as scripture along with the Bible. People who believed in this book and adhered to its teachings began to be called Mormons. In the early days of the church, the Mormon belief in modern-day revelation, additional scriptures, living prophets, and other factors made them the subject of intense persecution.
Between 1830 and 1840, Joseph Smith and the Mormons settled in several locations on the frontier of America. Each time, prejudice and misunderstanding caused intense persecution, which drove the Mormons out. Eventually, they settled in Missouri, but after a short time, problems again surfaced.
As the members and voting power of the Mormons grew, so did the animosity. A series of incidents escalated the misunderstanding between the Mormons and the Missourians. After casualties on both sides and without much thought into the problem, Governor Boggs ordered the expulsion or the extermination of the Mormons from Missouri soil. Fearing for their lives, they fled in the night to Illinois, leaving their land and their possessions.
The Mormons bought some unwanted swampland on the banks of the Mississippi River and began to improve the area. Joseph Smith called the new settlement Nauvoo, a Hebrew word meaning beautiful.
It was in 1841 that Joseph Smith made known a revelation that he had received in 1831 while reading passages in the Old Testament. Joseph pondered and prayed about why certain patriarchs of the Bible had more than one wife. He received the answer that under certain circumstances, this law was ordained by God. In 1844, Nauvoo was the largest city in Illinois, with more than 13,000 Mormon residents and its own charter and militia. The political and economic influence of the Mormons in Illinois had developed to such a degree that prejudice and persecution again grew to an untenable point. As conflict grew, a sequence of events culminated in the assassination of Joseph Smith while in an Illinois jail. Brigham Young, now the new leader of the church, knew that the church could not continue in Illinois.
In late 1845, Preparations for a great migration in the spring of 1846 were in full swing. Every work area in Nauvoo had been turned into a wagon shop, and by late November, 1,500 wagons had been built. This flurry of activity concerned some in the government because they were unsure as to where this great migration would settle. At long last, on February 15, 1846, Brigham Young led the faithful Mormons out of Nauvoo, across the frozen Mississippi River into Iowa, in what would become the most well-organized and largest westward trek of pioneers in American history. But Brigham's wagon trains were different from all the other pioneers using the trails across the West. Brigham asked the groups at times to stop and plant crops and build shelters for the endless stream of Mormon pioneers that he was sure would follow. During the march across Iowa, one of the leaders, William Clayton, composed a hymn which illustrates the drive and dedication of the pioneers together as a people. At nights around the campfire, the saints would sing the hymn to boost their spirits. This hymn, Come, Come, Ye Saints, was sung by many pioneer companies as they crossed the plains. Finally, on June 14th, the first group of immigrants arrived in Council Bluffs, Iowa, just across the Missouri River from what is today Omaha, Nebraska. They decided to spend the winter there, and the place was appropriately called Winter Quarters. The winter of 1846 and 47 was particularly harsh and hard on the company at winter quarters. Diseases such as malaria and blackleg scurvy ran through the camps, causing over 600 deaths. Brigham Young himself experienced the deaths of two of his wives. By early in the spring of 1847, Brigham led out from winter quarters a vanguard company to try to find the new home Joseph Smith had described. The group was well disciplined. They rose at 5 and retired at 9. Averaging 10 miles a day. In Wyoming, Brigham Young met up with mountain man Moses Harris. His accounts of this semi-arid land were very discouraging to Brigham, but it was probably his later visit with Jim Bridger that was most disheartening. Jim Bridger said the land was too inhospitable to try to farm and offered, as the legend goes, $1,000 for the first bushel of corn produced out of the Great Salt Lake Basin. A group of Mormons from back east had landed by ship in San Francisco the summer before and were awaiting Brigham's arrival in the Bay Area. When Sam Brannan learned that Brigham's possible destination was the Great Basin, he rode out over 1,000 miles to talk to him. "Come to California," Brannan said. "It has clover up to the bellies of the horses." But talk of this beautiful land did not entice Brigham. He wanted a land that no one else wanted, a place where he and the Mormons could be left in peace. At Fort Bridger, Brigham decided to take the Hastings Cutoff into the Salt Lake Valley. This is the trail that had been taken by the troubled Donner Reed party just about a year earlier. Their demise was due in part to the extra time they took in blazing this trail. Although still a torturous path, it made the going easier for the last 80 miles or so into the Great Basin. An advance party, led by Apostle Orson Pratt, was sent out to scout the best way into the valley. This group entered the Salt Lake Valley on July 21st and immediately planted crops. The last few days of the trip into the Salt Lake Valley were miserable for Brigham, who was stricken with Colorado tick fever. What did he say as he peered out over the Great Basin? Wilfred Woodruff reported that he said, "It is enough. This is the right place. Drive on." Mormons believe that Brigham Young was driven by a vision. They look upon Brigham as a modern-day Moses, a prophet leading his people to Zion.
The pioneer company that set out from winter quarters was a crack crew, nearly all men who were especially trained and prepared to found a settlement. It was 143 men, three women and two children. And so that was their duty, was to try to make a place where people could live, because they knew there were people going to be behind them on the trail that year and certainly more people the next year. So they immediately began all the scouting operations that you would expect. They explored the area to see where they could find timber. They climbed up on Ensign Peak and looked out over the valley to get a sense of where the streams were, where the streams lay. They designated people to build roads up into the canyons and to begin to harvest logs so they could build log houses. They put a whip saw in operation to saw those logs with.
2 days later, after this pioneering company had traveled 1,400 miles, as we now find ourselves on Ensign Peak, they chose to climb to this high peak. The reason was is that Brigham Young had seen this peak in vision. Brigham Young then said, you could look east, north, south, or west, but there would never be a better place to settle than here, because he felt that he knew it from the Lord.
Meanwhile, back at Winter Quarters, the federal government became concerned that the Mormons might overstay their welcome on what was Indian land, so they asked them to leave as soon as possible. This stepped up the timetable for bringing more Mormon immigrants into the valley and put a strain on those trying to provide housing and food for the ever-expanding colony.
Well, they were really lucky that first winter of 47-48, actually, in one sense, which was that it was a very mild winter, and they were able to continue work on trying to build houses and trying to plant and plow. It was still a matter of concern to have enough food for the people that were there. They found early on that the sego lily has a nice bulb that is very edible and nutritious, and during a winter when they could eat only meat, would provide a kind of vegetable supplement to their diet. So that's one of the reasons the sego lily was later made by the legislature the state flower of Utah. It's very clear that that summer of 48, it looked like their crops were coming along well. It looked very promising. And then, of course, these hordes of crickets began to descend upon the fields, and they did everything they could to fight them back. They dug ditches, they burned fires along the ditches, they beat them back with hoes and shovels. But the quantity of grasshoppers was just overwhelming, and they were denuding everything in their path. And it was at this stage that seagulls began to descend from the west and began to feed voraciously on the crickets. And as apparently they had done from time immemorial, many of them flew to the waters of the Great Salt Lake and there disgorged the crickets that they had ate and came back and ate more. This was seen by the pioneers as an answer to prayer, as a miracle. And they regarded it as such. They were able to save enough of their crops to be able to survive that very difficult early and hard winter of 48-49 that contrasted very sharply with the previous winter of 47-48. Of course, that's the reason the legislature later made the seagull the state bird and the reason that it's protected in Utah.
When Orson Pratt and company came into the valley 2 days before Brigham Young, they camped on a site which is today occupied by the city-county building. After planting a few furrows of corn, a ditch was dug from City Creek to irrigate the seeds.
Although other groups had practiced irrigation in the arid American Southwest for centuries before the Mormons arrived, irrigation became a kind of hallmark of Mormon communities. In fact, it was said in the 19th century that Mormons were able to make water run uphill.
The Latter-day Saints felt a sense of destiny about their arrival in this particular valley, and read with particular interest from the Bible the prophetic words that they hoped would soon describe their efforts. The wilderness and solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose.
Very early on, the pioneers saw this land as a divinely chosen homeland for them. And the significance of this location can be seen in the way that they thought about the environment. They saw these mountain valleys as fulfilling the prophecies of Isaiah that Zion in the last days would be established in the tops of the mountains.
When Mormons moved out of the United States and across the wilderness, they called themselves the Camp of Israel. The Camp of Israel moving to a new promised land, a promised land called Utah. Utah, this new Zion, had its own Dead Sea connected by a river to a fresh body of water, very much resembling the Galilee, the River Jordan, and the Dead Sea of Israel.
Well, 4 days after Brigham Young arrived in the valley, he and the other apostles went to a spot near the separation of two branches of City Creek, and Brigham Young struck his cane to the earth and said, "This is the place we will build a temple to our God." And at that time, laid out the city in concept as well, and the model for that The city that he had laid out was Joseph Smith's plat for the city of Zion, initially developed in 1833, and Brigham Young actually had that plat with him when he came into the valley. Another main theme was its cardinal orientation, so that the wide streets were oriented to the cardinal compass directions, north, south, and east and west, which made large square blocks and lots that were also square. So in the original Zion plat and also in Salt Lake City, you see wide boulevards, 132 feet wide. Well, they weren't just to facilitate transportation around the valley, but actually what they were trying to do is to replicate on earth what they imagined the city of God to be in heaven.
Another concept which both Joseph Smith and Brigham Young embraced was the curtailing of land speculation. When settlers came to Utah, they were assigned land in an orderly manner and in keeping with the size and needs of their family. This was done copying the precedent set by Mormon towns in Missouri. This precluded wild and erratic land claims, where the early comers carved out the most fertile or forested areas for themselves, leaving the inferior lands for those coming after. No matter what land was given to a particular family, they were encouraged to beautify it.
Build cities, adorn your habitations, make gardens, orchards, and vineyards, and render the earth so pleasant that when you look upon your labors, you may do so with pleasure, and that angels may delight to come and visit your beautiful locations.
Some have credited Brigham Young with being an extraordinary agent with the native tribes. And early on, the Mormons lived in peace. But the native people of the area revered this land as their God-given homeland as well. And so, all was not well in Zion.
I would like to share a few insights with you from the native tribe the state is named after. The Ute creation story is Sonoiv, the creator, was breaking limbs off from a tree and putting them into a bag. He went away to rest, and while he went away, the coyote came, and his curiosity opened the bag, and out came all the people that he had put in the bag, going all different directions. When the creator came back, Sonoiv, he opened the bag and seeing that coyote had let his people out, he reached inside the bag and there were one group of people, the Utes. So he pulled them out of the bag and said, "You are my people, you will be with me." And he put them high in the mountaintops to be with him.
There are eight native tribes in Utah, each with their own heritage. The Goshute, Navajo, Northeastern Shoshone, Paiute, Southern Paiute, Skull Valley Goshute, White Mesa Ute, and the Uinta and Ouray Ute tribes.
We call ourselves Nuchu, Ute people. The Nuchu considered Utah, Colorado, Wyoming, and New Mexico their home. They lived in 12 different areas in bands. They wintered in the lowlands and summered in the highlands. The Spanish entered Ute country in 1600. They called the Utes Utas. That's where the name Utah comes from. The Spanish brought the horse with them. The Utes were one of the first tribes to receive the horse. This new mobility made them very powerful. The Mormons, or Mormons, as the old people call them, came in the 1840s. They wanted to convert the Utes. They were content with the lands they had at first, but their greed for more land confirmed their cry for manifest destiny. They felt the land was there to take and to use.
And use the land they did. As the endless stream of immigrant wagon trains rolled in off the prairie, the native tribes must have recognized that something big was happening, something they could not stop. The year 1848 brought some additional challenges to the Mormon community. Early in the year, gold was found near Sutter's Mill in California. Some early residents were attracted by the gold rush fever, which quickly swept the country. But Brigham Young was resolute in his opposition to those wishing to abandon the farm and family to chase the yellow mineral. With only a few exceptions, the Mormon settlers stood firm, but the rush toward California made Salt Lake a convenient stopover. In 1849, gold seekers headed for California filled the trails. Over 100,000 of these 49ers moved across the West, with hundreds passing through Salt Lake City every day. all were extremely thankful for this oasis on the American frontier. And Salt Lake later became known as the Crossroads of the West. The settlers capitalized on this increased trade, which brought in much-needed currency to help establish the Mormon colonies. The Great Salt Lake Desert was cruel to the 49ers, and many wagons and animals met their doom trying to cross it. Wagons loaded with fine merchandise headed for California had to be sold for pennies on the dollar in Salt Lake, or left for the scavengers somewhere along the route. For this reason as well, Salt Lake became a commerce town with many fine wares for very reasonable prices. Brigham Young was not content to have Salt Lake be a dusty frontier town. He wanted to establish a civilized society in the wilderness. He sent a letter to the Saints preparing for the Great Migration.
Bring all kinds of choice seeds of grain, vegetables, fruits, and shrubbery, trees and vines. Also the best stock of beasts, birds, fowls of every kind. Also the best tools of every description and machinery for spinning and weaving. And every implement and article within their knowledge that shall tend to promote the prosperity of any people.
By ox team, Brigham Young arranged for other cargo as well. A library of 2,000 books, machinery from France for making sugar out of beets, musical instruments, 2 tons of school books, and fine furniture. Directly west of downtown, Governor Young set aside a spot for a normal school for preparing teachers. This school was later named the University of Deseret, and in 1850, it became the University of Utah. During this period of 10 years, between 1847 and 1857, Brigham Young established a spectacular colonizing effort. Every fertile valley in the Great Basin was settled, and over 100 towns were founded. Not only around Salt Lake, but as far off as Las Vegas and San Bernardino in California. These settlements helped to establish a corridor to the south for purposes of trade and year-round immigrations. Many immigrants welcomed the civilization of Salt Lake City after a long and arduous trek across the plains, only to be told that after a few days' rest, they were to press on to Mormon colonies like Manti, Parowan, Beaver, Fillmore, or Las Vegas. This tested the faith of many of those tired pioneers, and perhaps more importantly, it tested their faith in Brigham Young. In addition to this colonizing effort, Brigham also was trying to strengthen his political hand with the U.S. government as well. Brigham understood the advantages of statehood and made plans to establish the State of Deseret. Deseret was a term taken from the Book of Mormon, which meant honeybee. The beehive motif is prominent on the state seal and the state flag, and Utah is still referred to as the Beehive State. Brigham's dream of the State of Deseret included a huge landmass, 1/6 the size of the current continental United States. In 1849, Brigham Young called a constitutional convention in order to officially form the State of Deseret. Messengers carried the invitation to all within the borders of the yet-to-be-formed state, both Mormon and Gentile. A constitution was hastily written, using the Iowa Constitution as a model. On March 12, 1849, a provisional government was set up with Brigham Young as the governor. A petition was sent to the U.S. Congress to establish this new State of Deseret, but it had no chance of passing. In 1850, California was admitted to the Union, and the territory of Utah was established by Congress. The name Deseret was unacceptable because of its religious derivation. The name Utah was derived from the Ute Indian tribe and meant people who live in the tops of the mountains. President Millard Fillmore appointed Brigham Young as the territorial governor. The governor decided to return the honor by establishing the first official capital of the territory of Utah in the new county of Millard and in the town of Fillmore. Governor Young addressed the new legislature and gave them advice on the fine art of lawmaking. He said that laws should be plain, easily understood, and few in number. It's interesting to note the first two laws passed by the new territorial government. First, a law allowing for the construction and care of a state road running from the Temple Square in Salt Lake to the far colonies in the south of the territory. Today, that state road still exists as State Street. The second law allowed for the establishment of the University of Deseret. The early government of the Mormon colony was basically the same as the religious organization. The people were grouped into wards, as they are to this day, which answered to a larger organization called a Stake of Zion. It was inevitable that tensions would mount when Millard Fillmore appointed non-Mormons from back east as officials in the new territorial government. These officials and Governor Young had a difference of opinion about the power each would have in Utah, and the appointees refused to turn over $24,000 to the legislature that was appropriated by the federal government. After a heated exchange, the appointees left Utah and returned to Washington, where they had little good to say about Brigham Young, the Mormon Church, or their somewhat secret practice of polygamy. In Europe, famine, poverty, and the Crimean War increased the desire of many Mormons to immigrate to their Zion. To help this inflow of immigrants coming into Utah, the church established the Perpetual Immigrating Fund in 1849. This was an ingenious method to keep money flowing to help fund the continual influx of immigrants. Those people who were needy would borrow from the fund, and once they got to the valley and got their feet under them, they were expected to pay back to the fund, with interest if they could, to pay for those who would come after. These new immigrants were extremely poor and had no money to buy wagons or supplies. The Perpetual Immigrating Fund was working successfully, but there was just not enough money to outfit the thousands of saints waiting at the Missouri River to cross the plains. And the wagon makers could not build wagons fast enough to make the westward trek in a timely manner.
Several 49ers passed through Salt Lake City on their way to the California gold fields with their belongings in wheelbarrows and hand carts. And that planted the idea in Brigham Young's mind that maybe the Latter-day Saints could do this too. In fact, in a letter he wrote to the church in 1851, he said, "If the 49ers can do it in honor of their God, gold, then the Latter-day Saints can certainly do it in honor of their God."
For the most part, the plan worked well. It was a little more arduous for the pioneers, but between 1856 and 1861, 4,000 pioneers came to Utah by handcart.
The disadvantages were that you could not take a lot of food with you. And as a result, there's hardly a diary that doesn't complain about the unrelenting hunger on the trip. People just did not get enough to eat. This particular hand cart would have carried about 400 to 500 pounds of goods. That seems like a lot, but the hand cart pioneers were only allowed to bring 17 pounds apiece. And those pounds would be equivalent to maybe an overnight bag that you might take on an airplane trip today.
Heartbroken women left precious heirlooms back in Iowa City or sold them for a few pennies. When they arrived in Salt Lake, most of them only had the clothes on their back. The hearts of the settlers in Salt Lake were softened by these new brothers and sisters, and many a handcart company was met at the mouth of the canyon with a brass band.
During the first year of immigration, 1856, there were five companies who traveled by handcart to Salt Lake City. The first three had a very successful journey. The trip went well, they came through in good time, faster than they would have with oxen and wagons. However, the last two companies left late in the season, and these people pulling their hand carts were caught in those snowstorms. The trip was difficult, there was not enough food, and in the terrible freezing temperatures, it became one of the greatest tragedies in American immigration history, with over 200 people out of just over 1,000 who died during that journey.
Just getting people across the plains was not the only problem. Once they arrived in Utah, they had to be assimilated into the society. Many new arrivals could not speak English, and there was a myriad of native languages to contend with, creating a miniature Tower of Babel environment. In order to remedy this problem, Brigham Young launched the Deseret Alphabet Experiment. This was an alphabet based wholly on phonetics. It was not a new language, as it used English words and sentence structure.
But the characters were not English characters. They were a composite of a variety of kinds of things from various languages and sources, and some invented. B's put backwards and T's tipped upside down and simplified. And it wasn't easy to learn, particularly when
everyone was speaking and writing English. And after about 20 years of effort and a lot of money, $20,000 to get the typeset, they came up with the first publications. There was a first reader, the Deseret first book, and a Deseret second book, both of which are like the McGuffey readers in that they offer to the children simple moral stories in the Deseret language. And a year or two later, around 1869, Orson Pratt brought out a partial edition of the Book of Mormon. And one of the most unusual uses of the alphabet was a gold coin. Brigham Young had issued coins in 1849 and 50, and then in 1860 they issued a special coin which has the lion on the back of it with the inscription, Holiness to the Lord, written in the Deseret alphabet.
Despite a great effort, the Deseret alphabet never caught on and was never adopted by the schools. It is appropriate to talk about the personal side of Brigham Young. As a polygamist, with many wives and many children, Brigham Young had much experience as a loving father, and he cared for the members of the church in much the same way.
A lot of people know that Brigham Young was known as the Lion of the Lord, and that's very true. Even though the people would come in destitute from on the wagon train into Salt Lake City, he would provide for anyone that came into the valley, but he also wanted them to work, and a lot of times there weren't jobs. And he had a rock pile in the back of the Beehive House that if there was no jobs available or anything that you could do, he'd make you move the rock pile so that you had a sense of accomplishment, and then he would provide for your family. Although Brigham Young probably didn't have a lot of formal schooling, he was able to conquer the West and be one of the great colonizers of all time, and that even makes it more impressive, I think, that he was able to do it from not a lot of formal schooling in Vermont to do those kind of things. He must have been born an absolute natural leader. There was a softness to him and a spirituality that, as you read his addresses, totally defies this Lion of the Lord image that we all have of him. I'm truly impressed and inspired in many ways to follow that lead.
Brigham Young always thought that the isolation of the Great Basin was not going to last long. He thought that he had about 10 years before the non-Mormons, or Gentiles as they called them, would invade their mountain sanctuary. When this prediction got back to the federal government, they perceived it as a threat to any newcomers. These types of miscommunication and rumors would cause great rifts between Utah and the federal government in years to come. In 1857 and 58, military action was taken against Utah and the Mormons in what would become known as the Utah War. This military campaign had far-reaching implications for Utah and the nation as a whole.
The question comes up as to how did all this happen, and there are three or four reasons that I think of. One was what came to be known as the Mormon problem. That is an uproar in the eastern part of the country and in California about the practice of plural marriage, which surfaced in the early 1850s. This in turn spilled into the national political campaign for the presidency in 1856, and the Republican Party, then a very young party, adopted an anti-polygamy and slavery platform, which James Buchanan, the Democratic candidate, then had to defend. By the time Buchanan took office in March of 1857, this had built up to a real head of steam to do, quote, something, unquote, about the Mormon problem. As it was originally designed, the Utah expedition was to involve about 2,500 troops drawn from 10 regiments, and then there was an additional brigade assigned to it as 1857 unfolded. All in all, nearly one-third of the U.S. Army was to be committed to Utah for this campaign. Most of us think of Albert Sidney Johnston as the main commander of the Army of Utah, but really the first commander for the expedition when it was formed was William S. Harney, a Tennessean. Harney had a reputation for brutality, stiffness, ferociousness that did not serve this whole conflict especially well. He was known as Squaw Killer Harney in Utah because of what he had done to the Sioux men and women and children at the Battle of Ash Hollow. His brutal execution of deserters during the Mexican War was well known, and he was an officer that the Army itself court-martialed four times during the course of his career, and he was tried a fifth time by a civil court in St. Louis for bludgeoning a female slave to death. When word of his command in the late spring of 1857 moved west, it set off a lot of apprehension in Utah. A a perception followed that this was just an armed mob of the sort Mormons had encountered in first Missouri and then Illinois, followed Harney's reputation and added to the controversy.
Brigham Young quickly made plans to defend his sanctuary from what he felt was an imminent hostile attack. Acting as governor of the territory, he gave orders to close off the borders and declared martial law. Two other key moves by Brigham Young would later cause him great concern. First, he enlisted the help of some of the Native American population who shared his mistrust of the military. Secondly, he sent word to the outlying colonies to store up foodstuffs in preparation for a long winter, in case they had to burn their crops in the fields, and also not to sell any grain to the Gentiles.
As you can hear from the traffic noise here in Echo Canyon, we're right by I-80. It's a main thoroughfare into the Salt Lake Valley now, and it was unpaved, but a main thoroughfare into the Salt Lake Valley in 1857. And so one of the main Mormon strategies in denying access to the army was to fortify this canyon. Breastworks, fortifications were built out of rocks, boulders, rifle pits were dug, streams were diverted to make it more difficult for federal troops to move through this area. And while this wasn't the only defensive system, it was one of the key ones, one of the most visible ones, and one of the ones that the Army worried the most about. One of the more prominent Navajo Legion officers who operated in this area was Major Lott Smith, who with a mounted detachment descended on a 74-wagon train of Russell's Majors and Waddell, the Army's freighting contractors. And one night on the Big Sandy, Lott Smith and his detachment, which included Porter Rockwell, descended on a Captain Simpson, who was the wagon captain of these 74 wagons, announced his intention to burn all of the wagons and their contents, to which Captain Simpson replied, "For God's sake, man, don't burn the wagons," to which Lott Smith replied, "It's for his sake that we're going to burn them," and he did. One of the witnesses to this event was an 11-year-old assistant teamster from Missouri, William F. Cody, whom we know as Buffalo Bill.
Later, the Mormon raiding party borrowed some tactics from the Indians and started prairie fires, which left nothing for the animals to graze on, and two forts, Fort Supply and Fort Bridger, were torched as well. More supply wagons were hastily sent out as the cost for this little excursion mounted. The beleaguered federal troops were forced to winter out in the elements where Fort Bridger used to stand. They suffered terribly from exposure and malnutrition. For once, the Eastern press helped the cause of the Mormons, as they reported the hardships the troops were forced to endure. The press and others called the Utah War a boondoggle. The New York Times said the whole Utah business was being mismanaged in the most extraordinary manner from the beginning. The New York Herald called the affair a needlessly desperate service. And the New York Tribune referred to Buchanan's part in the Utah War as shameful mismanagement. Senator Sam Houston from Texas echoed that sentiment on the Senate floor and said it was time to make peace with Brigham Young. Finally, the two warring factions came to an agreement. President Buchanan offered Brigham Young and his associates amnesty, and Governor Young agreed to allow Johnson's army to enter the Salt Lake Valley, but insisted that they establish their fort 30 miles outside of town. The fort was named Camp Floyd.
One of the more colorful parts about this campaign was the preparations in Salt Lake City. As soon as word reached Utah that Johnson's army was moving west from Fort Bridger in the spring of 1858, Salt Lake City in northern Utah was evacuated by order of Brigham Young. Some 30,000 people, refugees from northern Utah, were put on the road. The city was largely empty because of the evacuation of northern Utah, except small groups of men who were standing ready with torches and houses that had piles of sawdust piled up in case Albert Sidney Johnston violated his word not to stop in Salt Lake City. If a key question was why did all this happen, another key question is who won? And I'd make the case that no one really won. Everybody in one way or another was a loser. The federal government didn't win. The Army did not come into Utah on its own terms. There was a negotiated settlement. And you could argue that Brigham Young and the Mormon population did not win. Economic hardship for the LDS side, tremendous economic costs also for the federal government. The cost estimates range between $14 and $40 million for this campaign. To put two brigades into Utah 2,000 miles away from the East Coast cost an enormous amount of money, and it came just on the eve of what became known as the financial panic of 1857. The federal treasury, when Lincoln took office from Buchanan, was bankrupt.
The part of the negotiated peace that was hardest on the Mormons was that Brigham Young surrendered the governorship to Alfred Cumming, and there would never again be a Mormon governor until Utah achieved statehood 39 years later. The 10 years of isolation for the Mormons, predicted by Brigham Young, for all intents and purposes, ended with the arrival of federal troops in Utah.
Basically, there are two ways to interpret the Mountain Meadows Massacre. The first way I'll call the Arkansas story. And to non-Mormon historians, they see it as an act of revenge for the death of Parley P. Pratt, who was murdered in Arkansas earlier in 1857. And for these people, it's directed and executed at the orders of Brigham Young. It's an act of vengeance. It's a simple matter. The Mormons, on the other hand, tend to say that it was the act of a few deluded fanatics in southern Utah. The truth probably lies someplace in between. Now, Young, of course, was faced with a terrible political problem in 1857, how to deal with the army coming into Utah. He had to have the support and help of the Indians. He met with a group of southern Indian chiefs on the 1st of September, and he directed them to take the stock of the immigrants. And that is probably what sets the events that lead to Mountain Meadows in motion. I'm sitting right now on the fortifications that were raised in late 1857 by the Mormon militia. We're right at the mouth of Little Immigration Canyon, where overland parties would begin the climb over the Wasatch Mountains and into the Salt Lake Valley. Late in July of 1857, a party of immigrants from Arkansas, called today the Fancher Party, reached this point, made the climb, and arrived in Salt Lake Valley in the middle of a hornet's nest. Brigham Young has ordered the Mormons to preserve their food supply, not to sell grain to passing immigrants. The Fanchers have a big cattle herd. As they head south through Utah, they're eating up the Mormons' winter pasture. They're getting more and more aggravated with the Mormons who won't sell them food. By the time they get to Cedar City, there's probably a confrontation between the young, irresponsible cowboys with the Fanchers and the local people. It seems likely that somebody said, "We helped kill Joseph Smith, and we're going to California. We'll come back with the army, and we'll help kill the rest of you." Now, when they say that, they essentially sign their death warrant.
A group of Indians attacked the train while they camped at Mountain Meadows. But the immigrants fought back and dug in. After several days of fighting, the Mormon leaders in Cedar City recognized that they had a serious problem. They dispatched a man to Salt Lake City to ask Brigham Young what to do. Before his return, however, things got out of control.
He brings back a letter from Brigham Young that says, "The Indians are going to do what they want, but don't harm the immigrants." Haslam reaches Cedar City on Sunday, September 13th. He gives the message to Isaac Haight, the state president. Haight cries, "The immigrants have all been killed by the Mormons and the Indians."
Although the isolation the Saints had enjoyed quickly deteriorated, Brigham Young still ruled supreme in the territory, even though he was no longer the governor. But the Comstock Lode Silver Strike in Nevada, and later gold strikes in Colorado, caused large tracts of land to be carved out of the Utah Territory. These areas were really out of the control of the Mormon Church, so it didn't affect the Mormons directly at first, other than bringing more Gentiles closer to Zion. The term Gentile was not considered derogatory by the Mormons or others, and soon the Gentiles brandished the term with pride. Johnston's army also brought a new breed of pioneer to the Utah Territory. Jewish merchants set up shop near Camp Floyd, where hard government currency was used instead of barter or church scrip. Many Jews liked the adventure in the wild American West over the ghettos of the East. Besides, the Jews found Utah a curious place. It was the only spot in the world where a Jew is a Gentile.
Just a few years after the Mormons had found their promised land in Utah, Jews came to the Salt Lake Valley. They came as merchants. The relationship between Jews and Mormons has been close from the very beginning. Brigham Young donated land to the Jewish community for a cemetery. During high holiday services, Mormon church buildings were given to Jews for use.
As the Civil War approached, the Utah Territorial Legislature voted to tolerate slavery within its borders. The Mormon Church's official stand, surprisingly, was that slavery was not wrong as long as the slaves were treated humanely. To most Latter-day Saints, including Brigham Young, the idea of owning slaves was offensive and did not make sense within their economic system. The census of 1860 showed that Utah had a Negro population of 59, 29 slaves, and 30 free. This ambiguity caused the southern states to offer Utah statehood in their new confederacy, with no strings attached to the practice of polygamy. Although he wanted statehood, Brigham Young declined the offer. It was during the rush to secede from the Union by most southern states that Brigham Young tried to gain statehood for Utah a third time. He said, "We will show our loyalty by trying to get in while others are trying to get out." In 1862, the attempt for statehood failed again. The Civil War also gave the Mormons a reprieve from federal intervention. Johnston's army was recalled, and in their haste to leave, left millions of dollars worth of equipment behind, which the colonists bought for pennies on the dollar. It was also ironic that General Johnston, upon his return east, joined forces with the Confederacy and became one of their most prominent generals. Although it seemed that Utah could enjoy some peace while the rest of the country was occupied with the Civil War, it was not to be. Perhaps the first problem was the governorship of the territory. Governor Harding was appointed after Alfred Cumming, and he and his successors were faced with the same reality. Regardless of title, Brigham Young was the real leader and held the real power. This was one factor that once again focused the attention of the Congress on the Mormon problem. Congress in 1862 passed a bill which threatened the Mormon way of life. The Morrell Anti-Bigamy Act called for the fining and imprisonment of anyone practicing polygamy. Moreover, it stated that no religious organization could own more than $50,000 worth of property in any territory. Rumors circulated in 1862 in Washington that Utah, by the direction of Brigham Young and because of the Morrell Act, would secede from the Union and join the Confederacy. Although such rumors were false, Abraham Lincoln ordered a force of 850 men to march from California to Salt Lake. The troops were led by Patrick Edward Connor, who by his own admission hated Brigham Young and the Mormons. He defiantly marched his troops past Brigham Young's Beehive House and established Fort Douglas on the foothills overlooking downtown Salt Lake. Tensions between the two factions raced toward a breaking point as Connor pointed his cannons at the Beehive House and Brigham Young referred to the governor of the Utah Territory, Stephen Harding, as a sack of cow dung. Governor Harding was bound and determined that Young's power over the governorship would stop, and he and Patrick Connor concocted a plan to have Young arrested based on the Morrell anti-bigamy law. But Brigham effectively thwarted any attempts by Harding and Connor to arrest him by activating the Mormon militia of 2,000 men, which surrounded the Beehive House. Scaffolding was brought in to serve as guard towers, and cannons and telescopes were aimed at Fort Douglas. Eventually, President Lincoln, being much more preoccupied by the Civil War, decided, as he put it, to treat Brigham Young and the Mormons like he treated a knotty hemlock log on his farm that he could neither burn or pull out, so he merely plowed around it. This attitude gave Brigham Young some breathing room in Mormondom, but on the outskirts of the territory, the government was carving away at the kingdom. In 1861, much of Nevada was carved away from the territory, and over the next few years, the rest of present-day Nevada was taken away. A portion of Wyoming was taken away and given to the territory of Colorado, bringing Utah to its present-day borders. Colonel Patrick Connor had his wings clipped by Abe Lincoln. But his most profound impact on the history of the state of Utah, as it turned out, came not with rifle and cannon, but with pick and shovel. Brigham Young was very much against the speculative nature of mining for precious metals. So in order to wrestle power away from Brigham Young, Patrick Connor organized numerous expeditions to search for gold and silver and copper and other precious metals, knowing that any such find would bring in large numbers of non-Mormon miners. Soon a silver vein was discovered in Bingham Canyon in the Ochre Range of Mountains, which forms the western boundary of the Salt Lake Valley. Other mineral deposits were found in the Wasatch Range, but all the discoveries by Connor's men were quite modest. These explorations, however, did form the groundwork for much larger claims a few years later. Abraham Lincoln once predicted that Utah would be the treasure trove of the nation, and surprisingly, his prediction was true. But it took another event, the coming of the railroad, before mining enterprises became economically feasible. In 1862, Congress declared its intentions to build a transcontinental railroad. And on May 10, 1869, that dream became a reality at Promontory Point in Utah. Brigham welcomed the railroad, but he knew that the railroad would be a double-edged sword. Not only did it bring in the Mormon faithful, but it brought in the Gentile as well. Soon, mining towns like Alta, Park City, Eureka, Silver Reef, and Ophir sprang up, just as mining towns elsewhere had done. These towns flourished for a while, and when the claims ran out, they turned to ghost towns. But the miners discovered something besides minerals. They found that a couple of wooden slats tied to their shoes made it easy to go down the snowy mountains. In the 20th century, many of these ghost towns were revitalized by white gold. Alta, Park City, and Brighton, all mining towns, found their strategic locations in the mountains, perfect for the relatively new sport of skiing. In 1870, the Mormons made up 97.9% of Utah's population. By 1880, the percentage of Mormons had dropped to 62.9%. Although Brigham Young was apprehensive about the influence the Gentiles would have on the isolated Mormon colonies of Utah, in retrospect, non-Mormon immigrants had many positive and long-lasting effects. From the time the first Mormon pioneers arrived, education was important to Utahns. The early schools were called ward schools because they were held in the ward houses of the various Mormon communities. These ward houses, for reasons of economy, held school classes during weekdays, community meetings on weeknights, and worship services on Sunday. Money or hard currency was extremely scarce, so the teachers were paid in kind. It was said that many early Utah teachers had to carry their pay home in a wheelbarrow. This system of schooling continued with varying levels of success for over 40 years. When the Episcopal Church opened St. Mark's School in 1867, and offered a free education to all who would come, the ward schools lost a significant number of students. These schools, called mission schools, also served to proselytize, and the Mormon Church discouraged Mormons from attending them. Soon the Catholics were also offering free public education in Utah. Meanwhile, more Mormon immigrants were arriving all the time, and Brigham Young continued colonizing. He started 25 new Mormon settlements in the rugged area of northern Arizona and southeastern Utah. These areas were primarily controlled by native peoples. And after several bloody skirmishes with the native residents, Brigham sent Jacob Hamblin down to the area to negotiate a peace. As with relations in the rest of the territory, the cultures of the new settlers and the native people were incompatible. And as conflicts escalated, there were deaths on both sides.
Most of the Utes didn't go along with being farmers. They understood hunting and gathering and the way of life that they had, and they weren't going to be farmers. The Utes fought back in the Walker and Black Hawk Wars. The Mormons called for the removal of the Uinta Utes to the Uinta Valley Reservation in 1864. President Lincoln established the reservation for the Utah Utes here in the Uinta Basin. The reservation boundary is described as peak to peak of the Uinta Mountains.
During the time of the Civil War, Brigham Young became concerned with price gouging by local non-Mormon merchants, but was even more concerned about the newfangled styles for women coming in from the East. Brigham Young frowned upon low necklines and other revealing traits. From the pulpit, Brigham encouraged the saints to stay away from the merchants as much as possible and to rely on homespun goods. Late in 1866, a petition was sent to Brigham Young with the signatures of 23 of the non-Mormon merchants, offering to sell out their stores to the church and leave the territory. Instead of buying out the merchants, which Young believed would not be a good idea politically, he decided to start the rival Zion's Cooperative Mercantile Institution, or ZCMI for short. Mormon wards and stakes, which are their congregational divisions, were assigned different products to manufacture. These products were made communally, and the profits were distributed in the same manner. When CCMI opened in 1868, the all-seeing eye with the inscription, "Holiness to the Lord," appeared over the doorways. In response to this signage, one Gentile merchant, J.K. Trombo, made his own rival insignia, which spelled out Trombo's Creed. But the sign was torn down by Mormon youth the same day it was erected. Later, Young expanded upon the ZCMI concept and established different versions of the United Order, the communal government that Mormons believed would be instituted in heaven. In Orderville, as well as in other United Order communities, all land was held in common, and all work was shared. The residents ate together in large halls, and food was stored in central locations. Today, in Utah, the large department store ZCMI no longer relies on the cooperative concept of the 1870s. Shortly after the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad, entrepreneurs erected a brash little town named Corinne, where the railroad crossed the Bear River. This town served as a transfer point for freight and passengers for the railroad north to Idaho and the gold fields of Montana. The town was a magnet for Gentiles and anti-Mormons in particular. In 1870, during tight economic times, hard feelings between Mormon merchants and Jewish merchants caused many Jews to relocate to Corinne. For the next 9 years, Corinne was a thorn in the side of Brigham Young and a vexation to the Mormons throughout Utah. In its heyday, Corinne boasted 100 saloons and 80 accommodating women. Ironically, it was also in Corinne where the first Protestant church was erected. The Mormon press wrote of the residents of Corinne as rotten, miserable, stinking wretches and the very stench from the bottomless pit. Rumors spread that Brigham Young had laid a curse upon Corinne and its inhabitants, saying that the ungodly will get to fighting among themselves and kill each other off, and predicted that soon grass would grow in the streets. In Corinne, a new political party, the Liberal Party, wrestled some of the power away from the popular Mormon People's Party. In 1878, the Utah and Northern Railroad captured the northbound freight traffic, and the Gentiles soon left Corinne, which was quickly transformed into a sleepy Mormon farming community. One day after the arrival of the Vanguard group into the valley in 1847, Brigham Young marked out where the temple would be built. But progress was very slow on the Salt Lake Temple, because it was being built out of granite, which had to be cut from the mountains near Little Cottonwood Canyon. Utah's famous tabernacle on Temple Square was an engineering marvel for its time. The building was used for church-wide meetings called General Conference, and is still used for that purpose to this day.
Thy children mighty by
Brigham Young wanted temples built more quickly and soon called for new construction in St. George, Manti, and Logan. The Salt Lake Temple was finally completed in 1893. An amusing folktale surrounds the completion of the St. George Temple. The tower of the newly constructed temple was inspected by Brigham Young, and he was dissatisfied with the squatty appearance and suggested that it be enlarged. All around him agreed with his appraisal, but 2 years later, no attempt had yet been made to change the tower to meet his specifications. In 1877, Brigham Young died, and a short time later, a lightning bolt struck the squatty temple tower and burned it to its stone base. When the tower was finally rebuilt, it finally met Brigham Young's specifications.
In the early to mid-1870s, gold and silver were discovered in Utah, and miners poured into the area. Because Brigham Young discouraged mining by Mormons, almost all of the miners who came here were non-Mormon, and many of them were from the British Isles. Among them were Catholics and Episcopalians. Shortly behind these new immigrants were the clergy, who provided, or who tried to provide, a religious experience for their faithful. Unlike some of the other Protestant clergy, Catholics and Episcopalians were not too concerned with trying to convert Mormons or save their women from polygamy. They just wanted to provide for their own people. Bishop Tuttle, the first Episcopal bishop of Utah, came to Salt Lake City in 1867. Here he founded this Cathedral of St. Mark in 1870 and consecrated it in 1882. He also founded St. Mark's School in the 1870s. And this was of particular importance because here in Utah, the schools were basically parochial schools run by the LDS Church. The Mormons wanted their children to receive religious as well as secular schooling. Those few children who were not LDS were forced to join these ward schools or be taught at home. Father Lawrence Scanlon, an Irish Catholic priest who subsequently became bishop of the Catholic Diocese of Salt Lake, followed his parishioners around from one mining camp to another to look after them. As the strikes gave out, he moved on from towns like Ophir and Silver Reef. Meanwhile, Catholic nuns entered the Salt Lake Valley, and the Sisters of the Holy Cross established hospitals in Salt Lake City and in Ogden. They also established academies and parochial schools, which were frequented by all faiths, including Mormons. The relationship between the Mormon Church and the Catholic and Episcopal clergy was quite respectful, similar, in fact, to the relationship between Mormons and Jews. While visiting the mining camp of Silver Reef, for example, Father Scanlon was offered the use of the St. George Tabernacle for Mass, and the Tabernacle Choir sang for the service. As Irish and other Catholic miners raised their fortunes out of gold and silver, they were very grateful and generous to the Catholic Church. The Cathedral of the Madeleine, which was built in the early part of this century, was an eventual result of that generosity.
It's interesting to note that General Connor's attempts to grab power, the press's barbs that were thrown at the Mormons, the government threats of action, the mining boom, all did less to bring about change than the positive efforts by the cooperative non-Mormon clergy. In 1877, Brigham Young, who was in relatively good health for a man 76 years old, suddenly became deathly ill. On August 29th, this extraordinary colonizer, governor of the brief state of Deseret and the territory of Utah, and prophet of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, passed away. His final words were, "Joseph, Joseph, Joseph."
The same year that Brigham Young died, 1877, was the year of the Reynolds case, deliberately tested by the Mormon Church to test in the Supreme Court whether or not polygamy as a religious practice wasn't protected under the First Amendment. The Supreme Court ruled no, that federal government could, in fact, rule against or make laws against the practice of polygamy, that it was a practice that offended public morals, and therefore it was not protected under First Amendment. The Mormon Church was shocked but went on. The third president, John Taylor, determined to uphold the practice of polygamy, determined to abide by it as a religious practice, and so he announced that it would continue.
After Governor Murray arrived in Utah in 1880, he wasted no time in raising a candidate to oppose George Q. Cannon as representative for the territory of Utah to the U.S. House of Representatives. Although Cannon defeated the liberal candidate, Alan G. Campbell, by over a 13-to-1 vote ratio, Governor Murray declared Campbell the winner because Cannon was a polygamist.
In 1869, the National Congress determined that there would be an experiment in women's suffrage in the Western Territories. Safe, few women, Wyoming in 1869, Utah in 1870. And in Utah, there was the added incentive that perhaps by giving the vote to women, they would overthrow polygamy, they would overthrow Mormon authority, and they would become liberated, and this was the solution to solving the question of polygamy. For 17 years, women voted in Utah, and they voted consistently to uphold Mormon authorities running for office. This frustrated people at the national level. They attempted to tinker again with voting procedures, with democracy in Utah. In 1882, the Edmunds Act, denying voting rights to men practicing polygamy. Men were told that they had to take an oath before they could vote, that they had to vow that they were not cohabiting with more than one wife.
In defending the Edmunds Act, Representative Haskell said, "It is the intention of this bill to legislate out of office the infamous Mormon priesthood and give an opportunity to put in honest men." 1 month after the Edmunds bill was passed, a mass movement for statehood was launched. The Constitutional Convention met on April 10, 1882, but once again, Utah was denied statehood. The federal government, in the meantime, chose a new course of action: vigorous enforcement of the anti-polygamy clause in the Edmunds Act.
That still didn't seem to undermine or to throw off the power of the Mormon Church in Utah. So let's try another act, 1887, the Edmunds-Tucker Act. Now we're going to take a vote not only away from polygamous men, but also from women. Mormons practicing polygamy tried various tactics to get out of the way of federal officials. The underground within Utah, moving into the outskirts of the Mormon corridor, establishing locations such as Hanksville that were refuge areas that could easily be dispersed into the hills, into the countryside, even eventually moving into northern Mexico. Not far from here was DO, the code word for the home in which John Taylor resided on the underground. The underground, hiding out from federal officials as a polygamist, determined to continue the practice. Federal officials determined to arrest him. This is where John Taylor died, still hunted, still determined that he would uphold the religious principles of his faith.
As hundreds of men and some women were sentenced to jail terms of multiple years, prisons quickly became overcrowded. By the end of this judicial crusade, the government has spent over $100,000 building new prisons in Utah to house all the convicted polygamists. Besides Corinne, there were other Gentile strongholds. Tooele County, heavily populated with miners, was a stronghold of the Liberal Party and was nicknamed the Republic of Tooele. Park City, a mining community in Summit County, also elected a Liberal candidate to the legislature in 1885. And after the demise of Corinne in 1879, Park City became the unofficial Gentile capital of Utah. In 1887, the battle escalated. Congress passed the Edmunds-Tucker Act, adding a crucial clause to the Edmunds Act of 1882. The federal government declared the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints disincorporated and ordered all property owned by the church in excess of $50,000 to be seized by the government. On July 29, 1887, President John Taylor was buried. On July 30th, suits were filed in Utah Supreme Court to take control of church property.
1887 was the sixth try for statehood, and several things happened at that time, and probably the most important was that the Mormons simply decided this is never going to happen. Well, the liberals and the Gentiles and the federal government feared statehood, because if statehood was granted,
then of course the Mormons, they felt, would have a great deal more control. Because of the desire to be a state and to alleviate the fears of those who oppose statehood, the Utah Constitution was much more specific. I don't know of any other constitution, state constitutions, that specifically prohibit polygamy. I don't know of any other state constitutions that have such a strict separation of church and state. In 1889, the result of that sixth attempt was that Utah was denied, but Idaho and Wyoming and North and South Dakota were granted statehood.
In response to this olive branch offered by the church, the government backed off on prosecuting polygamists in the early 1890s. Still, by this time, over 1,000 polygamists had been prosecuted. George Q. Cannon, first counselor to President Wilford Woodruff, said in July of 1889,
"I have been assured hundreds of times by men of wisdom and discernment that our overthrow was inevitable. Unless we conformed to the demands of public opinion and renounced all peculiarities of faith, and that it was a folly to suppose that we could withstand these continued assaults upon us."
In 1889, obviously Ogden was still a very Mormon community, and yet they elected a liberal state representative. That's a pretty good signal when you've got these large Mormon majorities that someone who is opposed to these policies was elected to the legislature. But there were messages in and outside the church. No doubt about it, there were people within the church too saying, look, if we're ever going to get statehood, we have got to be more realistic about the situation in Congress and what it will take for us to become a state. And that is why Wilford Woodruff in 1890 issued the manifesto discouraging polygamy among the Mormons. But even then, that was not sufficient. It took several more years because they wanted to watch the Mormons. And that's why it took until 1896 to finally obtain statehood.
After all the melodrama involved in turning Utah from a territory to a state, it is appropriate to look upon the true heroes of Utah, the everyday settler who, in the midst of war and ballyhoo, continued to grub the earth by hand, sell wool blankets for seed, take odd jobs, and do chores for others, and all the time raise his hand to sustain the brethren. But even the hardened miner would have to admit that the solid farming communities were the only way to bring stability to this semi-arid place. For as the mining camps boomed and busted, and the rich and famous came and moved away, the Mormon immigrant farmer, having left his faraway homeland, driven by something more than money or freedom, stayed and conquered the sometimes inhospitable lands of Utah. In 1899, the Mormon church could see that the arable lands and readily available irrigation water had made Utah saturated with farms, and they therefore realized it was time to abandon their practice of urging members to gather to Zion and instead urge them to build up their stakes of Zion where they were. However, immigrants continued to come to Utah, and farms began to spring up in outlying areas such as the Uinta Basin, Grand Valley, and the Pahvant Valley. As the Denver and Rio Grande Western Railroad pushed into Carbon County in central Utah, they found more than they were looking for.
When the railroads went through, they uncovered this enormous seam in Castle Gate. This Castle Gate seam was so thick, 22 feet thick, bituminous coal, low sulfur, high carbon content. In the East, financiers, entrepreneurs rushed to Carbon County. They bought land from farmers. supposedly for farming, but coal was sticking right out of the ground. So it was obvious they were buying this land to open coal mines. Thousands of immigrants were needed. I say immigrants because from Brigham Young's time, the church leaders had counseled their people to stay on the land. Brigham Young called the railroad towns sinks of pollution. In the late 1890s, the English-speaking miners went on strike in Carbon County, and Italians and Yugoslavs and Finns were brought in. In the early 1900s, these same immigrants learned a little of the ways of America, and they went on strike, and Greeks were brought in. When the Greeks later went on strike in Bingham Canyon in 1912, Mexicans were brought in.
These new immigrants were not greeted by a brass band, as were the Mormon pioneers. They were met with prejudice, extortion, and abhorrent living conditions perpetrated on them by the railroad and mining companies, as well as by labor bosses of their own nationality. Unlike the Mormon immigrants, these newcomers were not easily assimilated into Utah or American mainstream life. They stuck together in ethnic towns such as Helper, Magna, Price, Bingham, Murray, and Midvale. Their customs and religions also kept them apart. Many of their holidays and festivals from the old country are still observed with deep respect. Many of these immigrants thought of their excursion here in the U.S. as a temporary situation and wanted to return to their homeland after saving up their greenbacks. The great worldwide depression of the 30s put an end to all such hopes, and gradually the second and third generations of these Balkan and Mediterranean immigrants took their place in mainstream society.
Jews came to Clarion in 1911 to create initially what we would call today a kibbutz. It was created by 200 Jewish families coming from New York and Philadelphia. The Clarion Jews were told to come to Utah that the Mormons would treat them well, and in fact the Mormons did treat the Jewish farmers well. Clarion will fail as an attempt to restructure Jewish life as an agricultural colony. It lacked water, the soil was poor, there was internal dissension, and Clarion could not survive beyond 4 years. One colonist remembers his mother crying at the kitchen table night after night from the despair of having left her home in New York for a life on this bitter, bitter land.
While the immigrants scratched out an existence in squalid conditions, others were in a position to take advantage of the economic situation in Utah. One such entrepreneur was Thomas Kearns, a penniless miner who arrived in Park City in 1883. He discovered a rich vein of gold and started the Mayflower Mine. With his newfound fortune, he built a magnificent home, which today serves as the governor's mansion. He bought the Salt Lake Tribune and later served as a U.S. senator from Utah. Thomas Kearns was among the select few individuals in the latter part of the 19th century to make a fortune in mining. But in the early part of the 20th century, mining, already well established in Utah, took a phenomenal jump in productivity. A major advance in mining was introduced by L.L. Nunn, who utilized the new technology of alternating current electricity, pioneered by Nunn's good friend and genius, Nikola Tesla. Tesla and Nunn had tested the concept of AC electricity in nearby Telluride, Colorado. The use of the new current in the gold mine at Merkur made work much easier. Nearby Salt Lake City benefited from this new power source as well, and became the fifth city in the world to have alternating current. With this new boom in mining came a new string of Utah millionaires. Names like Dern, Jackling, Penrose, Newhouse, Weir and McNeil became famous, and many of the mansions in Salt Lake still stand as a legacy of their mining fortunes. Ore smelters were prevalent in the Salt Lake Valley, and in 1919, Salt Lake became the greatest smelting district in North America. Just 3 days after the Vanguard Group entered the Salt Lake Valley, an exploration party stopped along the south shores of the Great Salt Lake to swim in the shallow, briny water. The buoyant waters soon became a popular recreational spot for the new residents of the valley, especially for celebrating the 4th and 24th of July. It wasn't long before resorts began to spring up to capitalize on this curious salty sea. In 1870, John W. Young, third son of Brigham Young, established a humble retreat north of Salt Lake and straight west of Farmington, which was called, appropriately, Lake Park. One of the main attractions at Lake Park was a three-decker steamship, the City of Corinne, which ferried passengers to various points on the lake. Garfield, Black Rock, Lakeshore, and other resorts sprang up along the railway lines going both north and west from Salt Lake. Garfield, a popular swimming area west of Lake Point, was bought in 1892 by the Union Pacific Railroad. They put in over $150,000 to make this one of the premier resorts. But only 1 year later, Garfield was bested by perhaps the best amusement park west of Coney Island, Salt Air. Ironically, Salt Air was built by the Mormon Church and invested in by Mormon Church leaders. They were concerned with the lack of morals that they saw in some other resorts and decided to build their own. In 1896, when Simon Bamberger bought Lake Park, he moved the resort 4 miles east to an area with natural springs which fed into a lagoon. Since it was inappropriate to call it Lake Park anymore, he changed the name to Lagoon. It still stands today, Utah's only remaining amusement resort. Salt Air weathered the low lake levels to become a jewel in Utah's history. The Moorish architecture was designed by Kletting, who went on to design the Utah State Capitol, as well as the original Salt Palace in downtown Salt Lake City. The Salt Air Resort went through many transitions due to the fluctuating lake level and natural disasters such as fire and windstorms. However, the resort remained a main attraction, especially for the youth, through the Depression and World War II. As many big bands found their way to the shores of the Great Salt Lake, creating memories for an entire generation. In 1971, the original Salt Air burned to the ground, and a favorite haunt of a generation of Utahns was destroyed. Attempts by man to tame this Salton Sea have by and large been thwarted. Because of this, the Great Salt Lake still remains in a relatively natural state and can be appreciated for its rough beauty. The harshness and ruggedness of much of Utah helped protect some of its greatest assets into the 20th century. When the United States did its land survey in 1869, most of the rugged land of the Colorado Plateau was unclaimed by settlers. Although early on the settlers realized the great beauty of this land, there was nothing much they could do with it. It was unfit for farming or ranching, or even cutting a decent trail through the Red Rocks was nearly impossible. One early Mormon settler near present-day Tropic, Ebenezer Bryce, spent a great deal of time in a wash that was later named after him, Bryce Canyon. But when asked to describe this beautiful natural wonder, he put it into the perspective of an early colonizer. It's a hell of a place to lose a cow. He later moved from the area. His attitude was shared by many of the pioneers in the Red Rocks area. In consequence, the beautiful lands of southern Utah remained basically unsettled and in federal hands. In the 20th century, with the advent of the automobile and the improved highway systems, the real value of the Colorado Plateau was discovered. Tourism. At present, Utah has 5 national parks and 7 national park areas, more than any other state in the Union except California. Utah's first and most visited national park was called by the early Mormon pioneers Little Zion. John Wesley Powell, during his visit to the area, mapped the beautiful canyon and called it Makuntaweap, the Paiute name for the area. Zion National Park, as it is called today, was cut by the Virgin River, a major tributary of the Colorado River. Canyonlands was established as a national park in 1964 and is a rugged wilderness area. This was one of the areas claimed by the ancient Anasazi Indians, whose spectacular ruins can be seen throughout this immense park. Arches was established as a national park in 1971 and is one of the most visited of the national parks in Utah.
It has the highest concentration of natural arches in the world. Capitol Reef was established as a national monument in 1937 and as a national park in 1971, and remains one of the more out-of-the-way parks, and therefore the least visited of the five Utah parks. The Capitol Reef area was home to the Fremont Native culture, and later to the Mormon pioneer community of Fruta. Another highlight along the Colorado Plateau is the Glen Canyon National Recreation Area, which includes Lake Powell, one of the world's largest man-made lakes. Lake Powell was named after the famous explorer of the Colorado River. It took more than 10 years to fill the huge lake. Lake Powell has also opened access to 96 canyons, most of which were inaccessible before the waters provided a liquid highway to hundreds of thousands of boaters each year. Lake Powell has approximately 2,000 miles of shoreline. The wilderness areas of Utah were once awesome barriers to expansion, which were cursed and scorned. But now, they have turned into one of Utah's greatest assets.
The Ute tribe has mixed emotions about Utah's centennial. The state is named after the Utes, yet statehood meant the loss of Ute lands, way of life, and being forced onto the Uinta-Ouray Ute Reservation. We cannot change what has happened in the past. This centennial, it is time to acknowledge what has happened to the native tribes of Utah and start the healing for the tribes and the entire state. The Ute tribe is willing to work together with towns, counties, and the state to make Utah a good place to live. Thank you.
We end our illustrated history of Utah where we began. Down the road from here stands the tall granite shaft of Mahon Rai Young's Monument to the Pioneers. This is the place State Park lies at the mouth of Immigration Canyon and reflects the words of Brigham Young. But as author Wallace Stegner said, whether Brigham Young actually said them, or Wilfred Woodruff, or whether they crystallized out of history as myth crystallizes out of the acts of living men, these are the right words. They say what should here be said. This is the place, the Holy City, New Jerusalem, Zion in the Valley of the Mountains, and also a provincial capital, thriving center of what the Chamber of Commerce likes to call the Intermountain Empire. And this feeling goes for all of the state, whether Mormon, Gentile, farmer, or city dweller. This is the right place. As we race toward the year 2000 and a new millennium, what will make us still the right place will be based largely upon the land and the environment which surrounds us, but more importantly, on the indomitable spirit of those who live here. Our home will always be in the tops of the mountains.